You have fallen into Event Horizon with John Michael Godier. John is joined today by Dr. Fatima Ebrahimi. Dr. Fatima Ebrahimi is a principal research physicist at the PPPL Theory Department and an affiliated research scholar at the Department of Astrophysical Sciences at Princeton University. Dr. Ebrahimi received her PhD in plasma physics from the University of Wisconsin-Madison in 2003. Her research interests span from magnetically confined fusion plasmas to flow-driven plasmas such as accretion disks. Her primary research experience has been in the field of theoretical and global computational extended magnetohydrodynamics, with wide applications to astrophysical, laboratory, and fusion plasmas.
Fatima Ebrahimi, welcome to the program.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Now, you recently wrote a paper in detailing a propulsion system that uses magnetic reconnection and fusion energy it promises to really expand the solar system, essentially, because greater speeds are possible with this and with that greater areas of the solar system. Could you give us an overview of how the system works at its most basic level?
Yes, so this is basically this thruster concept, rocket thruster concept is a new way to actually accelerate plasma to very high velocity, as you mentioned, based on the magnetic reconnection process. So it basically uses a really fundamental physical mechanism to produce high exhaust velocity. And that's the process of magnetic reconnection. So what you can just see that basically rocket concepts, donut shape plasma, you know, conducting gas, basically a plasma ring will be expelled, shoot out from the back of the rocket. And that's how rockets is going to be propelled forward. And that's the basic mechanism. You can just see it is like solar flare type mechanism, which is the energy release is similar to what happens on the surface of our own sun. We know that sun is basically a huge magnetized natural experiment, we call it, and we love it as plasma physicists. We love our sun because it's so magnetized. There's a lot of magnetic energy built into that. So the process of magnetic reconnection, I can give you a little bit an intro to that, that basically they are like invisible field lines we can assume on the surface of the sun, like, you know, a rope or like a string, that these field lines, basically, you can see that they are, you can just kind of bend them and they are open at the end. And when you put them on the surface of the sun, because of the motions on the sun, these open ended or footprints of these field lines starts to move. And as they move, actually, they can be twisted. They're twisted. And that's when the process of magnetic reconnection happens. And that's the basically conversion of the magnetic energy to kinetic energy. And that's what we use for this thruster concept. At these locations, we call it reconnection sites, the oppositely directed field lines. They basically come together and then they make, we call it X point. They make some kind of X point area. And that's where the magnetic field is kind of become almost zero, and then that's where you have to conserve, and then energy will be converted to kinetic energy. And the interesting thing is that basically, based on the observation, we know that these huge eruptions happen on the surface of the sun. The structures and also the plasma particles, they basically move, expel pretty fast, 100 to thousands of kilometers per second. So this is nature says that I can make, you know, this kind of velocity for you based on these process of magnetic reconnection. And that's the fundamentals of this new thruster concept, that I would just say that using these basic concept of the reconnection, we can actually use that to accelerate plasma to very, very high exhaust velocity, and that's the basic of it. Yeah.
Now, what kind of speeds are we talking about as opposed to a normal impulse type rocket? How much faster can we go with this idea?
Yeah, so there are great questions. So there are thrusters, chemical rockets. We know that they kind of be launched from Earth to, any other orbits or moon. So those kind of chemical rockets, they're kind of their gas mileage. You can kind of see this way. Gas mileage is kind of not that great. Is that their speed, the exhaust velocity is about, 4 kilometers per second or something. And also the something called the specific impulse, which shows the fuel efficiency for these chemical rockets are kind of not that great, 400 seconds, you could just say. And so you kind of need a lot of fuel to basically for these rockets to operate and go long distances, with thousands of tons, you can just say you need a few fuel for them to be actually operating. And also it's not really practical for these long distance travel in space. It takes years or months depending of the load, payload that you have. And so these are the rockets we have now. And then there are also other thrusters that they are not for, again, launching from getting out of the gravity. They are mostly electrostatic or based on the electric field, those thrusters. And those are also, there are different types. They have kind of some limitations. I don't think that they would not be able to get this to this kind of high velocity, exhaust velocity. They can get to tens of kilometers per second compared to hundreds of kilometers per second. That's what you can say. So there are some limitations for how much, a specific impulse you can have or exhaust velocity you can have in those thrusters. And they don't use magnetic fields efficiently because basically this thruster is saying that you need kind of magnetic reconnection to kind of make it efficient. So the process, again, giving you a little bit background, is that these plasma or magnetic bubbles or rings of plasma, when they leave the device, so they are born, as they are born, they are detached. And that's really unique in this process, that they are spontaneously are formed, these bubbles, magnetic bubbles, but also due to the reconnection process, they are kind of born and detached. And this is very unique for this concept. Other thrusters, they don't do this kind of a spontaneous and continuous, they don't use this kind of a spontaneous and continuous fast magnetic reconnection. So they leave the device, but also it's kind of, you can just say that it's self-pulsed. So you don't need external pulsing for the plasma formation and also for the plasma leaving the device or particles leaving the device. This is basically self-pulsed. So I would just say that, yeah, it's basically self-pulse, and also it produces a lot of exhaust velocity. So it's just a new mechanism to kind of make these kind of velocities that we need for long distance travel, from low Earth orbit to moon and also low moon orbit to beyond Mars and beyond that. So that's what. And the idea, actually, when you mentioned fusion, so the idea is that came to me because my background is fusion plasma physics and also astrophysical plasma physics. When I was working to simulate some of these current formation for this current startup formation in a tokamak experiment we have in Princeton, NSTX, National Spherical Tokamak Experiment, I kind of saw how this fast magnetic reconnection can produce these kind of objects. And then when I just basically, the side effect of that study was that, I can use this actually for thrust because I see these objects, travel and move pretty fast. And the only thing that is enabling here is the process of fast magnetic reconnection.
Today's show is sponsored by Audible. With Audible, you can find the largest selection of audiobooks ranging from bestsellers and new releases to original entertainment from top celebrity creators and thousands of popular and binge-worthy podcasts. Our favourite is The Martian by previous Event Horizon guest Andy Weir. The Martian on Audible now features a brand new narration by the incomparable Will Wheaton and includes bonus content from the writings of main character Mark Watney. Also, with Audible Plus, you'll gain full access to the popular Plus catalogue, where you can listen all you want to thousands and thousands of popular audiobooks, original entertainment and podcasts, including ad-free versions of your favourite shows and exclusive series. And for the fellow listeners who like to relax to something while you drift off to sleep, there's guided meditation and sleep tracks, all available to download and stream so you can listen anywhere on any device. Visit audible.com/eventhorizon or text Event Horizon to 500-500.
What about the exhaust fuels? Where it doesn't seem to have a limitation is what gas you can use to actually propel the craft. So what is the advantage to, say, using hydrogen as opposed to something like xenon?
Yeah, I mean, it's basically, fuel is really important. You know, when you go to travel, anything, even on Earth, you know, we need to care about what type of fuel we use and what it is. And there is no gas station, you know, in this space. So we need to be thinking about, for long distance travel, what is the possibility? How can we, you know, out there, what's out there, you know, is it what's available? And so we need gas for the plasma, and that's light gas, you know, hydrogen, deuterium, different isotope of hydrogen we can use here. And that's unique again here. You don't need to have very heavy gas to kind of make better thrust. So even hydrogen light gas, it's possible, because the exhaust velocity, again, since it's due to the magnetic reconnection, it's actually variable in terms of you can use different strength of the magnetic field and get different thrust and exhaust velocity. So therefore, your thrust is kind of, you can even get thrust because of the high speed velocity. You can get, you know, ion or the whole plasmoid will be accelerated to the high velocity. So then we use basically, the proposal is used basically, you can use lighter gas to ionize and make the plasma, and then the plasma, due to the reconnection process, the plasmoid structure will leave the device. And that's important because also, if you're looking at the future, we want to be able to actually extract, you know, these kind of available, you know, hydrogen, probably from asteroid belt, and use them for fuel. If there is a station, imagine on the moon or something around that, we can also, you know, these thrusters, because of the highest speed, you can actually use it for also providing, you know, bringing back and forth, you know, fuel. And that's what they're specific.
Now, in a broader sense, what of interstellar travel?
You can, I think, this will enable those kind of long distance travel, Mars or beyond. So this is the concept as a plasma physicist I came up with. And so we can study and do some more research. What are the other, you know, options? You know, there, I don't know what's the limit for these high exhaust velocity. There might be higher than what I have in the paper. But there's also the question of how much power you need to put into the device. And that's like, based on the paper, the power is, you can also use, you know, solar power rocket for this thruster, lower power. And then the distance you can go is kind of limited because you're using less power, solar power. But then when you use this kind of, you provide higher power, input power, then you can, based on this, you can use this thruster concept for very long distance. I said Mars beyond because that was my end point, but you can, I don't know, it's probably more than that, maybe hundreds of AU astronomical unit, you can just assume. But again, the nice thing is that there are many companies and people are working on providing power in space. I mean, the easiest thing is that, you know, 50 kilowatt or 100 kilowatt, you can get it from the sun, but through the solar power. But also if you want higher, you can using, you know, nuclear fission, you can go to much higher power and then basically longer distances. Yeah. And people are working. And as soon as basically they talking to other people working, you know, on the nuclear propulsion, it looks like that in the next 10 years, basically, tens of megawatt power through nuclear fission will be available for space. So that's a nice thing about this thruster concept, that it doesn't care what kind of power you provide. As long as you provide the power, it can provide the thrust and the exhaust velocity you need. It could also use as, in addition to fission, can also use fusion, but that's kind of longer term, because you kind of really need to have net gain with the fusion to be able to actually use the fusion effectively for power. But that's kind of more next few decades, I would just say. But fission for high power, I think few megawatt provided in the next 10 years, this thruster concept can be used for long distance travel.
What inspired the idea?
Yes. Yes. So I think that's interesting, because through my career, I've been working with magnetic field. You know, we use magnetic field to basically confine fusion plasma. That's what we use. That's what magnetic confinement is for fusion experiment. So, and also I do some studies in, for example, for accretion disk around black holes. You know, I study a lot, you know, the dynamo process means that generation of the large scale magnetic field through different, you know, turbulent in these accretion flows around, you know, black holes. So I study these kind of things. So to me, the magnetic field is really important. That's what I do. How they are generated. And that's actually the opposite of magnetic conduction. The dynamo process is basically using flows, different types of plasma flows to generate magnetic fields. So it's conversion of the kinetic energy to magnetic energy, and nature does it for you. That's how sun operates. That's how our you know, Earth produces its own magnetic field, and it's also supporting us from all these solar wind particles that are coming to us. So it's basically magnetic field for me is really important. I work with it a lot, and then how you dissipate this magnetic field in our plasmas, for example, in fusion plasma, and that's the process of magnetic reconnection. So I work a lot for the process of magnetic reconnection in fusion plasmas. And the interesting thing is that basically magnetic reconnection is kind of bursty, and it releases a lot of energy. And for fusion plasma, you just don't want that, for example, in some places like edge of the plasma, close to the wall. You don't want these things. But when I was working on the current formation, startup current formation, that how you actually start the plasma, how do you actually form electric current in the fusion device, a spherical tokamak, then I found out that actually fast magnetic reconnection is really good and useful for actually producing a lot of current in the plasma. So, and then I kind of magnetic reconnection is actually was useful. It's the opposite of sometimes people in fusion plasma, oh, we don't need that. But for that kind of a startup current formation, it was actually useful. And then I studied it a lot. And so it basically came from years and years of studies of this whole reconnection studied in fusion plasmas. And then specifically in that experiment or in that a startup experiment that I was working to. I was working on the theory and simulation of that experiment, and I saw these fast magnetic connection. And then at the time, I wasn't thinking about building a rocket and have a concept, but just it's just gradually, you know, comes to you. You know, that's how it is. Because of these connection between the different disciplines of plasma physics, I would just say it's actually plasma physics now is becoming really, really interesting, rich branch of physics. We have, you know, we work on, you know, fusion, astrophysics, you know, solar, and all those things. And then we are recently are trying to connect all these, you know, branches, like, okay, I'm doing fusion, but my work or my research is actually relevant also to astrophysical plasmas, in this case, to basically a rocket concept. So that's how it is. And I try to link all these things and work on these, basically see the similarities of the physics phenomena for different application. And that's how you kind of can link and work. And that's how I inspired, by working in fusion plasmas and other plasmas,
Just out of curiosity, I'm sure a lot of people are asking the question, could you give us an overview of a tokamak reactor?
Yes, so basically, tokamak is a concept that I think it was the late 50s or something, or early, that it's a Russian concept for magnetic confinement for fusion. What it is basically using, first, it's a donut-shaped device that plasma, you know, hot ionized gas, should actually, we have to get, fuse these very, very, fuse these light atoms, you know, light isotope of hydrogen, like deuterium or tritium, at very, very high temperature, hundreds of millions of degrees, they need to fuse, and then that's how you get fusion and the other due to the reaction. So you want to have the plasma or the gas in this donut-shaped chamber, the tokamak. And so how you have it is basically there is some kind of a transformer in the middle of this donut that kind of induces current in this chamber, and electrical current from the, we know that it will create magnetic field. So flowing current will give you magnetic field, and that's a nice thing. Now we are getting back to magnetic field. Magnetic field is an interesting, is a beautiful thing, and actually confine this hot ionized gas, this plasma. And that's the confinement is. So basically, and there are other types of coils basically we use for basically cage or putting this plasma in a magnetic cage, basically. Different types of magnetic field, you know, we call it toroidal, poloidal, vertical, to kind of put it where it's supposed to be in the middle of the chamber, you know, this donut. We don't want it touch the wall. Bad things happen, you don't want that, but it has to be flowing and high current confined with this magnetic field, and through that process you can get, you know, the fusion energy. And experiment TFTR and JETS in mid-90s, actually they showed that you can get fusion energy in a tokamak configuration, and they produced from the reaction of the nuclear reaction of deuterium, tritium, they produced energy, about 10 megawatt fusion energy, or maybe more, 17 megawatt. And so the next step has been basically, is there a net gain? Do you get more energy from the nuclear reaction compared to what you put in into this tokamak device? And that's the next step. And that's basically the ITER experiment. It's the International Tokamak Reactor Experiment in France that is being built. And the idea there, I mean, the goal or the mission there is basically do the next step, just basically produce more fusion power compared to what you put in. The gain of about, you know, 10, like 500, the goal is to get 500 kilowatt compared to what you put in, 50 500 megawatt compared to putting 50 megawatts. So that's the idea. So that's the tokamak. Basically a magnetic configuration, like a donut shape, you know, goes around. It has walls, vessels that confines the plasma, hot plasma in there. But that's not the only magnetic configuration to produce fusion. We have so many different types of magnetic configuration that they're promising to produce fusion. They have different types, you know, some have lower magnetic field, some have higher magnetic field, and not going to higher magnetic field is actually desirable because of the high temperature superconducting magnets. So there are different types of magnetic field in addition to tokamak, and it all needs to be explored for fusion energy. And some are getting some private funding to actually continue those paths, especially what we are interested, or basically it will be great to actually have some kind of a compact design for fusion energy. If we can get, you know, fusion energy, you know, at radius, you know, the device not too huge, more compact, and about that higher magnetic field, or the spherical tokamaks actually are kind of compact. They are not like kind of like a donut, they are kind of fatter. So that's what we are interested in how to do. And so it has branched out a lot to different types of magnetic configuration tokamak. But that's one of the first, I think, magnetic configuration that, or there were actually other ones, mirror types or something. There's so much history going on with the magnetic fusion confinement. Yeah, so much pinch type of, you know, forcing, you know, magnetic field, you know, in a linear device to kind of magnetic field forces the plasma in some area like a cylindrical. And then hopefully the problem with cylinder is that you actually have these ends and you lose some of the plasma in that case. But there are so many ideas. You use rotation, you know, to confine the plasma. So it's really fascinating, the whole thing. But yeah.
Now, best guess, how long do you think it will be before we have usable net gain fusion that we can power cities and spacecraft with?
Yeah, for fusion energy, so for both for our planet and also for space. So best guess. the big experiment that all everyone internationally people, you know, put their money and they have invested is the ITER project. And that is basically the first plasmas, I think 2025 or something like that, they will have the first plasma. And so of course there will be more research and things like that on that. And after that, you kind of need to think about the power plant based on fusion. And that's also another research people are working on. I don't know about the numbers exactly, because in parallel, we also have, you know, some kind of more innovative, more compact design is happening everywhere, especially in the US. We have, you know, at MIT, I mean, Commonwealth, they are working on high field tokamak. And they provide some dates, you know, but I'm not, I don't know, I don't want to get into all these things, but I think we are getting there, that's the thing. And the fact that there's so much interest, both from the private part and also governments to make this happen, that's really great. And the next couple of decades, I think we will get closer, but don't forget the net gain might be closer than what we think. Maybe in the next few years, we can get an eight gain with some of these compact designs. But then the other question is that to making it actually power, how do you get these energy that you produced, you know, effectively to put electricity, to generate electricity? That's also another engineering challenges. There are some engineering. So we have all these things that people are working on it. So I think it's great that there's so much interest and people are working on it. Yeah. And then your question was also for space propulsion. So I would think that whenever that happens, you can use it, you know, for especially for this more compact design, you can use it for space propulsion. But my rocket concept, you can basically provide the electricity with any kind of power, it will operate at high velocity. Yeah. It doesn't need need to wait for fusion to happen and then operate. No, we are thinking about different, you know, scales of it for different power, small power, provide with low power, how far we can go, higher power, how far we can go, yeah.
What's next for the thruster? What is the next step to realizing it?
Yeah, so for this thruster, my concept is basically, so it's really promising because of all this realistic simulation, and we have this proof of principle in the experiment that it shows these structures are forming, and also the whole concepts come from these, you know, realistic magnetohydrodynamic simulations. The next step, I'm talking to both, you know, everyone possibly, to actually build a device. So we need to build a device based on that. And there are people interested and think that this is kind of the fact that it's continuously is being made is really, to them, it's really promising and fascinating. So the next step is just building it. And it's because of the simplicity of this thruster concept, that's also attractive. You don't want it to be too complex putting in this space, and also anyway for any kind of application. So the simplicity of it makes it great. And so I would think that provided funding, we are going to build it in the next, you know, couple of years, proof of concept, and then gradually see at what power level we can do what and where we can use it for what application. And then it looks like in the 10 years the nuclear fusion will be available in space, and we can also use it for high power.
Absolutely amazing. Fatima, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you.
And I wish you great luck in building your prototype. And when you get there, I hope you'll come back and give us an update.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author.
Wrong channel.
No, it's not. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Gaudier, currently hosting Event Horizon and wondering where Anna actually came from. One day I had a tablet computer, the next I had a boss. Very disturbing. And be sure.
And that's enough of that.
YouTuber forever! Like, subscribe, and hit the bell!
Sell out.
What?